Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Killer Close to Home by Carol Light. Narrated by Whitney Dykhouse. Chapter 1.
I'd like you to stay a little later today.
Roscoe Tremaine leaned heavily on his walker.
I need you and Wink to witness some legal papers. That okay?
Crystal Ward resisted the urge to groan. Her day had already been long enough. An early meeting with a prospective client wanting to declutter the attic in her three-story home had been followed by a dirty garage reorganization, both squeezed in before a late, hasty lunch. She couldn't even remember what she'd eaten. She had been in Roscoe's overheated kitchen for 2 hours, mostly on her feet, sorting through and packing a lifetime of kitchenware. It was almost 4 and her children would be home soon. They both had keys, but still. Legal papers? She asked, stalling. Roscoe gave up standing and eased himself onto one of the round-backed chairs at the table while Chris was wrapping glassware. Watching him favor his right hip, recently replaced after a fall, softened her heart. Roscoe wasn't just a client of her organizing Chicago business. He was a neighbor and a special friend.
New will. My attorney's coming at 5.
But your family...
Yeah, they're still coming, but they won't stay long. Never do. And after I tell them I'm cutting them out, they'll disappear faster than a fart in a tornado.
He lowered his voice.
But I don't want them to know I'm changing the will today. None of their damn business anyhow.
Chris's hands stilled on a half-wrapped wine glass. She should mind her own business, but this was Roscoe. You're cutting them out of your will? Did something happen?
You don't approve.
He folded his hands on the table. His knuckles were raised knots on the weathered bark of his thick fingers.
Something you want to say?
It just seems extreme. You only have the one brother, and Arthur cares about you. He stopped by just yesterday to see how you were doing. She hadn't yet met the two nieces.
Artie's done well enough for himself. I'm still leaving him this property in case I croak before it sells, but that's it.
He flexed the fingers of his arthritic right hand as he massaged it with his left.
As for those two girls of his, they'll inherit from him when he passes, unless they piss him off.
His thick brows lowered.
They're not getting anything from me, and whichever one of them is trying to hurry me into my grave for my money is in for a rude awakening.
The doorbell rang before Chris could ask why he thought someone was trying to kill him.
That'll be them,
Roscoe said, pushing himself upright.
I'd appreciate it if you'd stay, Chris. I need you and Wink to have my back when I tell them.
His faded blue eyes twinkled beneath bushy gray brows.
3 against 3. Sounds like fair odds to me.
Chris resumed rolling the wine glass in paper. Roscoe would never beg or even say please, but he'd come as close as he ever would to asking for help. She glanced at the clock on the wall. An extra hour or so wouldn't kill her. Adding the glass to the cardboard box, she rose to text her son that she'd be late. The older niece, Gail DeGrassi, nodded curtly at Chris when Roscoe introduced her. Dressed in washed-out jeans and a pullover sweater the color of raw oatmeal, Gail had brown hair flecked with gray that she'd pulled back into a ponytail. She wore no makeup and no jewelry, other than plain silver hoop earrings.
You brought your girl, Roscoe said with a frown. Hillary,
he added as if the name had just occurred to him.
Of course I did. We both wanted to see you, Uncle.
Huh.
Roscoe's eyes narrowed at his teenaged great-niece. Hillary DeGrassi's checked school uniform was the only conventional part of her appearance. Her straight, dark hair was shaved above one ear to reveal multiple piercings, Longer locks fell from a side part to the top of her other ear. She lingered near the front door, talking to Wyatt Wink Keller, Roscoe's home health care aide.
"Hillary," Gail said sharply, "come say hello to Uncle Roscoe."
The girl gave her mother a resentful look and stalked over to shake hands with Roscoe. Wink's amused gaze met Chris's and he winked at her.
"Dad's coming from his office," Gail
continued in a voice better suited to an auditorium stage.
"I had to pick up Hillary at school. Mel must be running late, as usual."
"You win the prize for being first. Go in the kitchen and see if there's anything there you want before Chris here gives it all away,"
Roscoe said, rubbing his ear.
"You know I don't have a place of my own anymore, Uncle. I have a whole set of dishes in storage, along with pots, pans, and every utensil known to woman. The last thing I need is more stuff."
"Maybe you shouldn't have gotten divorced. Could have saved that money you're wasting on that storage locker."
Gail jerked her head back as if she'd been slapped.
"How I spend my money is my business, Uncle. As soon as I have my own place, I won't need a storage locker. And I'm not going to discuss Nick, other than to say he was the one with the brilliant idea of taking out a second mortgage. The house sale after we divorced paid off his debts, but left me with nothing to show for 15 years of marriage. Nothing."
"Other than your daughter." Hillary had plopped down on the sofa. Her half-smile seemed more amused than hurt. That didn't stop Chris from being angry at her mother for being so insensitive. Turning her gaze to Wink at Roscoe's side, Hillary crossed her legs and poked her lips out in a pout. If it was an attempt to flirt, her effort was wasted. Wink's attention was on Roscoe, who was turning his walker around.
"Suit yourself," Roscoe said to Gail over his shoulder. "I need to take a piss before the others come."
He shuffled toward the bathroom. Wink followed him, placing an encouraging hand on the older man's shoulder. There was no point in standing around.
"Are you sure there's nothing in the kitchen you might want?"
Chris asked Gail. Her gaze turned from mother to daughter to include Hillary in the offer.
"Maybe something to remind you of your Aunt Joan?"
"There's nothing I want from this place," Gail said.
"I just want to get this over with. I wouldn't mind some water, though. Why on earth does he keep it so hot in here?"
Chris didn't bother answering. Roscoe was nearly 80 and felt the cold more now that he was less active. In the kitchen, Chris returned to the table to resume working as Gail rinsed out one of the crystal tumblers waiting to be packed. A moment later, Hillary drifted in through the open doorway. She watched the wrapping process for a moment, but when Chris smiled at her, she wandered to the open shelves on the wall next to the table. Reaching up with both hands, she removed the delicately painted green teapot in the center of the open shelf.
"I think I might take this."
"What on earth do you want with a dusty old teapot?" her mother said. "Put that back."
Gail took another sip of water and then hefted the tumbler in her hand.
"Ugh, these glasses are so heavy. I don't know who would want them. Mel sure won't."
"Hopefully they'll find a good home somewhere," Chris replied, offering no sympathy. There were lighter glasses waiting to be packed that Gail could have used.
"Would you like some water, Hillary?"
"No."
When her mother cleared her throat, the girl added,
"Thank you."
Hillary set the teapot on the table. She removed her crossbody bag and dropped it into the nearest chair. Leaving her glass in the sink, Gail sat in the seat across from Chris and crossed her legs.
"Uncle Roscoe said you're a professional organizer. I thought he was paying a neighbor to do his packing."
"That's right. I live behind him, but I have a professional organizing business. It's more than packing. I'm helping him go through his belongings and determine what he wants to do with them."
"At least he's finally made up his mind to move into assisted living."
Chris replied with a noncommittal, "Yes." Hillary was now standing in front of the refrigerator. With a glance at her mother's back, she opened the door and began to examine the contents. Or maybe she was trying to cool off. Chris was tempted to join her.
"I work, too," Gail continued defensively. "I can't take care of him. Not that he'd want me to,"
her daughter snorted.
"And you're not much help, Missy,"
Gail said, turning around to catch Hillary feigning an innocent look a second after she'd closed the refrigerator door.
"You could be doing this on weekends and earning some pocket money. If I'd known the old skinflint was going to hire help, I would have volunteered you for the job."
"Weekends are when I work at the bar."
With a toss of her head, Hillary turned her back to them and walked past the sink toward the stove, trailing her fingers along the edge of the formica countertop.
"The ice cream bar," her mother clarified for Chris. "Anyhow, now's your chance to talk to Uncle Roscoe about your plans for the future before the others arrive. That was the whole point of picking you up early from school. He should be out of the bathroom by now. Be sure to tell him..."
Three clicks were followed by a whoosh. A flame leapt from a gas burner on the stove. Hillary jumped back with a nervous giggle.
"Shut that off," Gail said, rising.
"Geez, sometimes I swear you act like a 5-year-old.
Hillary twisted the knob and the fire disappeared.
"Go on," Gail told her daughter. "Talk to your uncle now before the others come."
She made a shooing motion with her hand when Hillary groaned.
"He'll be glad you did when he pays for your college education. You know I can't afford a day's tuition, much less 4 years. And as for your father..."
The doorbell diverted her conversational direction mid-sentence.
"Oh, that had better be Mel."
Hillary peered out into the living room.
"Dad's here, too."
"What?"
Gail hurried past her daughter into the other room.
"Dad's right behind me, if that's who you're looking for,"
the new arrival said a moment later. Her voice was smooth jazz to Gail's heavy metal, but carried easily into the kitchen.
"Brandon wanted to have a word before they came in."
"Why did you bring your husband? This is family business."
"Excuse me. Brandon is family. Just because you no longer have a husband..." "Oh, speak of the devil. Hello, Nick. Long time no see."
Paper rustled near Chris, distracting her from listening to Gail's angry greeting to her ex.
"Thanks, Hillary. You don't have to do that."
The girl shrugged and tucked the ends of the paper neatly inside the bowl of glass she'd just wrapped.
"You don't want to talk to your uncle?"
"Would you? Old people are pretty gross. Besides, Mel and Brandon are here now. Grandpa and Dad, too. Everyone wants his money, you know."
TMI. Chris didn't want to know about Roscoe's finances, although she had been surprised that he had chosen to move into one of the more expensive assisted living campuses in Chicago. The idea of him being wealthy wasn't really surprising. He and Joan were childless. They had lived simply in this 2-bedroom bungalow for 30 years. The kitchen and bathroom had never been remodeled, but Roscoe had kept the house in good repair. According to Connie, Chris's neighbor, the couple used to drive to Florida for 10 days every January, and that trip had seemed to be their only extravagance. Roscoe probably had built up a good nest egg, and his only brother and nieces were his apparent heirs. Or they had been. Any minute now, Roscoe would be telling them of his plan to change his will. Chris wiped sweat from her forehead with the back of her hand. Staying had been a mistake. Roscoe might enjoy being the bearer of bad news, but she didn't want any part in his big reveal. Didn't Roscoe realize that he was going to further alienate his nieces and possibly his brother? This was a terrible idea. And what had he meant about someone hurrying him to his grave?
"Hillary!"
Gail's shout from the other room startled Chris and provoked a dramatic sigh from her helper. The girl placed the goblet she'd just wrapped into the box and muttered something that sounded suspiciously like bitch before she rose and hoisted her bag over her head.
"Not my child," Chris pretended she hadn't heard. Hillary! Hi, sweetie!
The woman who had nearly collided with her helper as she entered the kitchen looked like a Barbie doll version of her sister, curvier, blonder, and more stylishly dressed in a green wool dress and knee-high brown leather boots. Carrying a plastic-wrapped tray of cheese and crackers in one hand, she reached for Hillary with her free arm for a quick hug that her niece only tolerated for a few seconds before breaking free and leaving them.
"Hello there," the woman set the tray on the kitchen counter. "I'm Melanie, Roscoe's niece. I thought we might want some refreshments for afterward."
Chris introduced herself. She knew this woman. Different clothes, less makeup.
"Didn't you come to the self-defense class at Kimball Martial Arts last month?"
Melanie asked.
"That was me."
Of course. That was where they'd met. So much for hoping that she would never encounter any of her classmates again. Melanie's lips twitched.
"That class was very instructive, especially the last day."
Heat rushed to Chris's already warm cheeks.
"Our instructor was quite a drill sergeant, wasn't he?"
Melanie continued.
"How can we forget? Slap, slap, slap! Eyes, eyes, eyes!"
Overcoming her embarrassment, Chris chimed in.
"Knees, knees, knees!"
They both laughed.
"Let's hope we never have to use it, although it will be a long time before I stop hearing his voice in my head,"
Melanie said. She fussed for a moment with the plastic wrap on the tray.
"So you're the neighbor Uncle R hired?"
"That's right. I'm a professional organizer. Your uncle hired me to help him sort through his belongings and prepare for his move."
Melanie flashed her a quick smile.
"I'm so glad you're helping him. There's not much worth keeping here, is there? He and Aunt Joan pinched pennies until they squealed and never changed anything."
She gazed around the dated kitchen, which was tiny by modern standards.
"Dad said Uncle R is moving to Millbrook. I thought for sure he'd choose somewhere cheaper, like one of the places Dad suggested."
She lowered her voice. "Poor old Uncle R is in for a shock when he starts rubbing elbows with that Millbrook crowd." Chris smiled.
"More likely the Millbrook crowd will be in for a shock meeting your uncle, but he'll be fine. I can't believe you're Roscoe's niece, and you're the artistic one, aren't you? Your uncle told me you painted the picture in his bedroom."
"That was a while ago," Melanie said.
"It's beautiful, and I love the landscapes in the living room. The colors are so vibrant."
Melanie stepped closer.
"Thank you. Actually..."
A sharp rap at the back door made them both jump. Melanie waved at the man peering in the glass and hurried to let him in. Next door, dogs started barking. Chris hoped Roscoe didn't hear them. He had called the police several times already in his ongoing feud with the Dashiells. The couple next door with two vocal terriers. The man who entered the kitchen, along with a welcome rush of cool air, appeared to be in his mid-40s. The sports jacket he wore under his open camel coat and his pressed slacks were more Brooks Brothers than J.C. Penney's.
"What were you doing in the backyard?" Melanie asked.
"Your dad said there'd been a leak in the basement. I was just looking around to see if I could spot where it might be coming from. Nothing I could see."
He ran a hand over his thick, wavy brown hair and gave Chris a broad smile.
"You're not a long-lost relative of Roscoe's, are you?"
"Brandon, meet Crystal Ward. She's helping Uncle R move."
"He's not taking kitchen stuff with him, is he?"
"No, silly,"
his wife said. She turned to Chris.
"What is he doing with it?" "He's donating most of it. Of course, if you or your family want anything..."
Brandon laughed.
"Not likely. Although maybe he should have someone come in to see if this old crystal has any value. Did he have an appraiser look at any of this?"
"Not as far as I know," Chris said.
Her spirits plummeted as she pictured having to undo her packing.
"Roscoe was pretty tight. It's probably not worth much," Brandon decided, glancing at the remaining glassware on the table. "Nobody wants this old crap anymore, especially not us. Right, honey?"
"I don't need anything," Mel said, touching her husband's arm. I have all I want. Although I might take the paintings if he's just going to toss them out. Her jaw tightened for a moment. Thanks, Chris, for mentioning them. Say, you might be interested in the Art League's exhibit next Thursday. She pulled a card from her shoulder bag. I have some watercolors in the show, and there will also be a lot of other artists' works. I think you'd enjoy it.
Hers are the best, Brandon said in a stage whisper.
Chris took the card. Thank you, Melanie. I would like to see more of your...
Mel, Brandon, there you are.
Arthur Tremaine was still in his business suit. Taller and about 10 years younger than his brother, he was also more polished than his sibling.
Roscoe's ready for us. Chris, he wants you to join us as well.
I'll be right there. She glanced again at the clock on the wall, although only 10 minutes had passed since she'd last looked at it. Her gaze dropped to the shelf below the clock. There was a gap where the green teapot had been. It was no longer on the table either. Hillary must have taken it, despite her mother's disapproval. One less item to pack. Chris stood and drew a deep breath. As close as her home was, it had never seemed so far away. Chapter 2. At Roscoe's insistence, Chris accepted the chair next to him that he'd directed Brandon to carry over from the adjoining dining room. Melanie, Gail, and Hillary had squeezed onto the sofa, while Arthur sat in the other armchair that had been Joan's. Brandon perched on the rolled arm of the sofa next to Melanie. Nick DeGrassi, who reminded Chris of a scruffy John Cusack, had also pulled up a dining room chair to complete the circle. Only Wink remained standing. He'd refused a seat, choosing instead to remain at Roscoe's side.
I'm changing my will, Roscoe announced without preamble. Artie, I'm still leaving this property to you, unless it sells first. It's going on the market as soon as I clear everything out. I already have an agent lined up. You already know all that.
Arthur's face was impassive. He nodded, apparently relaxed, although his index finger tapped like a heartbeat on the arm of the chair.
You said you didn't want my stamp collection, but I'm leaving it to you anyway. You can always donate it to the Chicago Philatelic Society if you don't want to keep it in the family, but I want you to have it as soon as I can find it.
Roscoe had already asked her to keep an eye out for it, but Chris made a mental note to search for the plastic tub containing his albums and stock books tomorrow.
Nick, I'm leaving my car to you, unless I decide to get rid of it before I die. You've taken good care of it all these years, and I appreciate it.
Gail's eyes narrowed at her ex. Her father gave her a quick shake of his head, and she kept whatever she was thinking to herself. Roscoe coughed and cleared his throat. As firm as his voice sounded, his emphysema was advanced enough to require oxygen several times a day. Coughing wasn't unusual for him, but a small frown line appeared on Wink's usually worry-free face. After taking a few shallow breaths, Roscoe continued.
I'm also adding 2 new bequests, $10,000 each, to go to Wyatt Keller and Crystal Ward.
Chris exchanged a shocked look with Wink. $10,000? That would mean so much to her family. Tears burned her eyes. She was overwhelmed by her neighbor's generosity and stunned, speechless.
Surprised you two, didn't I?
Roscoe chuckled. He pointed his finger and panned it at his relatives.
Not a word from any of you. These two have helped me more in the last few weeks than anyone, and I want to do this.
He waited a beat, but no one challenged him.
As for the rest of my estate,
Roscoe paused, heightening the drama.
I've decided to leave it to 3 charities that I've long supported.
What? You can't be serious, Gail exclaimed, breaking the shocked silence.
Dead serious.
Roscoe's voice was equally loud and surprisingly strong.
But I was counting on that money. You can't do this to us.
Gail looked at her father, whose finger had stilled on the padded chair arm.
Can and will. Maybe you'd better rethink that storage space you're renting.
But Uncle Roscoe, Melanie said, we're your family.
He laughed.
Family? I only see you when it suits you, or when you want something. When was the last time you and Brandon were here? Christmas? Nope. You were somewhere in Mexico, having a vacation.
I visited you in the hospital, Melanie mumbled. Maybe you just don't remember. Hillary and I have been coming every week since you broke your hip, Gail said.
She threw her arm around her daughter and squeezed Hillary, who winced.
She's your only great niece. I've done my best to make sure you two have had a chance to know each other.
Yeah, but you never came around when Joni was sick, did you? And it wasn't until you thought I was on my deathbed, ready to cash out. Roscoe, that's enough, Arthur said.
For a moment, there was silence. Melanie squeezed Brandon's hand. Gail's lips tightened in anger. Hillary shrugged out of her mother's grasp and leaned closer to her aunt. Even Roscoe seemed surprised that his brother had shushed him. Gail was the first to recover.
You're making a huge mistake. We'll have you declared incompetent. We'll fight you. Dad, tell him he can't do this.
Roscoe chuckled.
Yeah, tell him, Artie. It's my money, girl. And I'll do what I...
A fit of coughing overtook him, followed by a loud gasp as he tried to suck in air.
I'll get your oxygen, Wink said, giving Roscoe's shoulder a squeeze. Slow and steady breaths.
I'll get some water, Melanie said, jumping up.
Not sure what she could do other than offer reassurance, Chris stroked Roscoe's arm. Slow breaths, she repeated. Roscoe's mouth gaped as he continued to suck in air. Arthur was on his feet. He pulled his cell phone from his jacket pocket.
I'll call for the paramedics.
Roscoe shook his head and waved a hand.
No,
he croaked. Wink returned carrying a portable tank. He placed it on Roscoe's lap and fit the cannula over his patient's face before turning on the oxygen.
Maybe this conversation can continue another time,
Wink suggested to the group, as Melanie returned with water in one of the old jelly glasses Chris intended to throw away. Her face was pale and her hand shook, sloshing out some of the liquid.
Do we need to call 911?
Arthur asked Wink, pointing to the phone in his hand.
He should be fine in a few minutes, but it would be better if everyone left,
Wink said in his calm voice.
I think he's said all he wanted to say anyway, haven't you, Roscoe?
His patient nodded as he concentrated on breathing. Gail rose.
Don't you dare change anything in your will until we talk about this some more.
She pointed her finger at her uncle.
You're being unfair.
We do need to talk about this some more, Melanie agreed. But Uncle R needs to catch his breath. We need to go.
Roscoe had closed his eyes and hadn't noticed the glass of water she was offering. She placed it on the coffee table in front of him. Gail turned to her father.
I was counting on that money to pay for a house. And what about Hillary's college tuition? It's not like Nick's going to help. He...
Enough.
Arthur's voice was cold and hard.
Mel's right. Your uncle needs his rest. I'll check in with you tomorrow, Roscoe.
His brother didn't have enough breath to reply. He managed to raise his hand and motion a small wave. As Gail passed by him, Roscoe's fingers slowly curled into a fist, and then his middle finger popped up. Oblivious to her uncle's salute, Gail followed her father toward the front door.
Come on, Hillary, let's get out of here.
She didn't bother looking back to see if the girl was obeying. Nick had already escaped out the door ahead of them. Melanie trailed behind Gail. Her face was pinched with worry, and she seemed lost in her own thoughts. What had her plans for Roscoe's inheritance been? Only two family members noticed Roscoe's gesture. Hillary, slower to rise from the sofa, discreetly returned the obscene salute with her hand at her side and an amused smirk on her face. Allowing Hillary to precede him, Brandon's face tightened as he stared at Roscoe's finger. With a look of disgust, he followed the rest of the family out the door. As if he realized his audience had departed, Roscoe's hand relaxed. He was no longer gasping for air, but his weakness alarmed Chris. "Will he be okay?" she asked Wink.
"It happens now and then when he gets excited."
Roscoe opened his eyes and looked at her.
"Don't talk," Wink told him.
Instead, her neighbor gave her a thumbs up. Chris squeezed his wrist and rose to give them some room. Not in any hurry to return to the kitchen, Chris drifted over to the living room window. Outside, the two sisters and their father huddled at the edge of the driveway. Gail's cheeks flushed as she jabbed her finger toward the house. Mel shook her head and shot anxious glances at her husband, who stood about 10 feet away checking his cell phone. Hillary had also moved apart from her mother and the others. Headphones covered her ears and her head was lowered as she scrolled on her phone. Nick was in the street, unlocking his car as if he couldn't escape fast enough. Had he spoken to his daughter, or she to him? Nick's car was a beauty. A baby blue sedan circa 1960, with a squared front and back. Was he a man who cared more about cars than his child? After a final outburst and a reply from her father, Gail threw her hands up and the huddle disbanded, each to their own vehicles. Brandon and Melanie's navy BMW sedan backed out of the near side of the driveway first. Gail had parked next to Wink's Bronco. Her father was parked behind her, so she had to wait for his white Lexus to leave. Hillary hadn't yet followed her mother. She looked up from her phone and watched her father pull into a neighbor's driveway across the street. Chris's heart ached for the girl. She had been close to her own father and still missed him. She couldn't imagine what it was like for Hillary to live with a mother who hated her father and to not be able to see him every day. Maybe she didn't like Nick, or think she needed him. None of the Tremaines had been demonstrative or affectionate today, other than Melanie and Brandon. Hillary headed toward her mother's car and disappeared from sight. Across the street, a movement and flash of color caught Chris's eye. A woman of about her own age emerged on her front porch with a small dog on a leash. Her red wool coat made her as distinctive as a male cardinal in their dull winter surroundings. She walked down her drive with the dog tugging her along toward Nick Degrassi's car. If he was intending to complete a 3-point turnaround, oncoming traffic in the form of another sedan and a UPS truck had prevented him. The vehicles passed, but instead of leaving, Nick rolled down his window and smiled at the approaching woman. They chatted, and Nick gestured at Roscoe's house, causing the woman to look across the street. Chris stepped back involuntarily, although she was probably too far away from the window in the darkening room to be seen. Their conversation soon ended, and Nick rolled up his window and left. The woman crossed the street to use the sidewalk and soon disappeared from Chris's sight. Roscoe's breathing was regular and no longer labored. Wink had taken the seat Chris had vacated and was teasing Roscoe about scaring his audience away. Chris yawned and debated returning to the kitchen. Sitting was dangerous when she was this tired, especially in this warm house. Outside, a car door slammed. A woman in a suit and heels carrying a briefcase emerged from the shiny black Accord that had pulled into the driveway. Roscoe's attorney had arrived. This long day would soon be over.
10K, huh? I still can't believe it, Rick said after Chris told him about Roscoe's announcement.
Not much ever surprised her husband after years as a detective with Chicago's police department, but her news of their neighbor's generous gift had penetrated his "I've seen and heard everything" defenses. Neither could his family. You should have seen the looks they gave me and Wink, and that was before Roscoe told them that the rest of the estate was going to charity. When the shock wears off, they'll really hate us. Gail had made it clear that she wouldn't accept the new will. As generous as Roscoe's bequest to her and Wink was, Chris suspected it would seem to his family like adding insult to injury.
There are no guarantees anyone will see a penny of that money. Roscoe could outlive his assets, especially at a place like Millbrook, Rick said,
although they both knew their neighbor's health didn't look promising for a long life.
At least we don't have to worry about Kurt and Dana fighting over our estate, if you want to call it that.
Chris chose to ignore his lack of faith in her business taking them to estate status. They wouldn't fight over money. Maybe possession of the remote control. Rick laughed. They were still seated at the kitchen table after dinner. Squeals and applause from the game show their daughter Dana was watching burst sporadically from the television in the living room, after her parents had ruled that it was her turn to choose the programs to watch this evening. The thump of a bass beat throbbed above them. Their son Kurt had retreated to his bedroom after surrendering the contested remote control. She'd had similar squabbles with her brothers growing up, but they were close. What had caused the Tremaines to be so lacking in affection? I still don't understand why Roscoe would disinherit them all. I hate to say it, but he seemed to take pleasure in making them unhappy. I know it's his money, but they are family. Not a very happy family from what I saw, but still, I guess I never saw that side of Roscoe before.
You wouldn't.
Rick's hands were rubbing his thighs, a sigh that his paralyzed legs were either cramping or he was experiencing phantom pain.
When we first moved in, Rick continued, he told me that the back fence should be replaced, and our trees needed to be trimmed. I thought he was going to be a real hard ass.
He'd just sold his business, remember? Roscoe had owned a metal fabricating business, until his wife Joan had convinced him to sell it 6 years ago, when he was diagnosed with emphysema. He was adjusting to retirement and looking for someone to supervise. Rick raised an eyebrow.
Are you suggesting I needed supervision?
Well, you were a new homeowner. Admit it, you didn't know much about yards or home maintenance after living in apartments all your life. I seem to remember I had to show you how to operate a lawnmower, city boy.
I would have been fine with you mowing the grass.
His grin disappeared.
You had to take over doing it anyway.
But now our strapping son does the work for us.
And for his allowance.
Chris sipped her wine. She had been trying to drink alcohol less often, even though she rarely had more than one glass. But today she wanted to feel the cold Chardonnay sliding down her throat and helping her body to relax. Maybe tonight she would be able to fall into a deep, dreamless sleep for a change. Maybe pigs would fly too. There were too many thoughts about Roscoe's dramatic announcement still darting through her head to guarantee a peaceful slumber. Rick shifted in his wheelchair.
It's Roscoe's money, and money is power. He was used to being the boss, but now he doesn't have control over much of his life. Other than who gets his estate.
He still has control over how he treats people. Her husband's hands stilled on his thighs.
You haven't had any problems with him, have you?
No, of course not. He treats me well. Wink, too. It's his relatives he seems to enjoy tormenting.
Maybe they deserve it. Joan didn't have any family, did she?
No, she was an only child. Roscoe had been much happier when Joan was alive, back when she and Rick had first moved into the neighborhood. Roscoe and Joan were really kind to us, especially after you came home from the hospital.
He taught me to play chess.
Chris smiled. I'd forgotten about that. He came over several times a week for a while, didn't he?
You played for hours.
Until I returned to work, although I think he didn't like it that I could beat him by then.
Only some of the time, from what I remember. She fingered her wine glass. They were both kind to us. Right after you were shot, Joan brought food and offered to babysit if I needed help. I still miss her. Chris had brought several dinners to the Tremaine house after Joan started chemo just over a year ago, and then again after her death, only 2 months later. She should have realized how lonely Roscoe had become. Maybe if she hadn't been so focused on making her business a success.
She was a nice lady, Rick agreed. I like no-nonsense types.
Organized, efficient women who get down to business, Chris teased. Her husband grinned.
Especially when they get down to business.
Chris smiled. You must have had a good day.
Hell no. The new captain, Shulman, wants to shape us up and turn my team into a more productive unit.
Rick made air quotes with his fingers.
The dickhead doesn't know what he's talking about. He was lieutenant in crime prevention before his promotion.
I thought your friend on the cybercrime team was the leading contender for the job.
So did I.
He reached for his beer.
Maybe I should have applied.
Chris glanced at him, surprised at his admission. They had discussed the opening and the raise in salary that came with it. She hadn't encouraged or discouraged Rick from applying. He'd never said why he hadn't submitted an application. He might move on soon. You'll have another shot at it then if you want it. His gaze met hers.
I wouldn't be working cases. Not directly. I want to keep solving crimes, not supervising supervisors.
She nodded, relieved. A higher position would mean more stress for him, especially if it distanced him from the detective work he loved. That's what you're best at. Although you're a good supervisor, at least according to Mitch. Rick snorted.
He learned more than he bargained for being my partner, that's for sure.
Their partnership had ended the night Rick had been shot chasing a suspect. In the 5 years since then, Mitch Burdine had been promoted to lieutenant in the homicide division. Paralyzed from the bullet that had struck him, Rick had been assigned to the financial crimes team, where he'd been able to return to work in his wheelchair. It was a desk job, but at least he had remained a detective. Rick's mood was darkening. Chris changed the subject. Do you want me to run a background check on my new prospects? I had 3 emails today, although one may not work out. It was from a woman asking whether I organized outdoor spaces.
Outdoor spaces?
His shoulders relaxed.
She probably wants you to organize their junked cars or weed through their garden troll collection.
She laughed. As much as I like a new challenge, most likely she needs a landscape architect or gardener more than my services. Or maybe a junk dealer or troll wrangler, if your guess is right. I asked her for more specific information and pictures. You don't need to look that one up yet.
Okay, I'll get my iPad. Or do you want to do the dishes first?
Geez, you really are the no-nonsense type, aren't you? She pushed her chair back and reluctantly rose. After working in Roscoe's kitchen all afternoon, dealing with dishes and glasses, the thrill, if there ever had been one, was long gone.
I just don't want to be up all night,
Rick muttered. He coughed. Chris froze. Your voice sounds like you're getting a cold. He'd been sniffling earlier, too.
Just a little stuffy. It's nothing.
She tried to check his forehead, but he brushed her hand away.
No fever. Don't fuss.
She wouldn't fuss, but he couldn't stop her from worrying. They'd made it almost all the way through the winter without colds. Rick didn't look flushed, and he didn't seem any paler than his normal seasonal sun-deprived shade of white. Even so, she would try to convince him to take something before bed so he could have a good night's sleep. She pinned her own hopes on the glass of wine. Tomorrow had to be less stressful. But would it be?
She was scheduled to continue packing at Roscoe's house in the afternoon. The disinherited Tremaine family had threatened to return to talk to him. Chris didn't want to be anywhere near Roscoe's relatives when they discovered that he had already changed his will. Chapter 3. A loud boom blasted Chris from a deep sleep. A thud and crash upstairs were followed by a scream. Dana! Chris threw back the bed covers and bolted out of bed. Next to her, Rick raised himself to his elbows.
What the hell? That sounded like a bomb. Wait!
Chris was already at the door. The kids! I'll be back.
Mom!
Kurt called as she opened the bedroom door. What happened? She met him at the bottom of the stairs. His sister, wide-eyed, rushed down the steps behind him. They both started talking at once. All she heard was house, explosion, and fire. She wrapped her arms around their shoulders. You're both all right?
My window's broken, Kurt said. A chunk of wood came right through it.
Oh my God! She glanced upstairs, didn't see any smoke. Is it burning, Kurt?
I don't think so. I'll go check.
Before she could stop him, he'd broken free of her embrace and dashed back up the stairs. Don't step on glass! Be careful! Dana clutched Chris's sleeve and started crying. Is our house going to burn too? Chris squeezed her. Whose house is on fire?
Mr. Tremaine's, Dana said. It exploded!
Her son appeared at the top of the stairs.
It's not burning, Mom. I think it was just blasted through the window by the explosion. Was it a bomb?
I don't know. She had to make sure their house wasn't on fire. Kurt, go tell your dad what's happened and tell him to call 911. Dana, go with him. I'm going to check the back of the house.
Mommy, you need your shoes,
Dana said. Thanks, honey. Get my boots in the hall closet and my jacket. I'll meet you in the kitchen. A minute later, she'd grabbed Rick's large flashlight from the garage, which seemed undisturbed. She slipped into her boots and coat and unlocked the back door. Behind her, Dana gasped. Orange flames were shooting more than 10 feet into the air from Roscoe's house. Her garden hose would be as useful as spitting at the inferno now blazing.
Do you think Mr. Tremaine is okay?
Dana asked. I don't know, honey. I hope so. Chris's heart constricted. There was no way that Roscoe or anyone else in that house could have escaped. Hadn't Wink mentioned something about spending last night there? A smaller explosion shot sparks into the air, setting a branch of Roscoe's oak ablaze. Sparks blew toward her own tree. Bare of leaves, it was dry this time of year. There was still a chance to save it if she could wet it down. Chris opened the storm door. Next to her, Dana whimpered and gripped her coat.
Mom, don't go out there, please. It's dangerous.
Chris made herself stop and address Dana's all-too-real fear of losing a parent. I'll be very careful. Tell Kurt to bundle up and come help me. I need you to check all the windows inside and see if any others are broken, but don't go into Kurt's room where all that glass is. Can you do that? Dana nodded. Put some shoes on just in case there's glass on the floor somewhere else. But Dana, first go tell your father that Mr. Tremaine's house is destroyed, and I'm going to hose down the tree and the back of our house. And don't worry, the fire department should be here soon.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.